I think it's just about time to get started. I'm Sean Lovejoy. I'm actually the chair of the Nonlinear Geophysics Focus Group, and I'm standing in fact, for Armin Bunde, who's the chair of the Lorenz Lecture Committee, who can't be here today. So it's my pleasure to introduce then this morning our Lorenz lecturer for 2011, Alvaro Corral. And Dr. Corral got his PhD at the University of Barcelona in 1997. He did a postdoc at the Niels Bohr Institute in Copenhagen with Per Bach, who, of course, many of you know is father of self-organized criticality, which is a big NG theme. And in 2001, he has been a fellow, Ramon y Cajal, probably totally mispronounced that, fellow of statistical physics at the group of the Universitat Autonoma of Barcelona, and which I guess he's been there since then. And his research has been in a wide area of, I suppose you could call complexity in nature, geocomplexity, or even beyond geo, in fact. So, because he's made applications to language, music, earthquakes, forest fires, rainfall, hurricanes, and in fact all kinds of experimental, numerical, and theoretical papers and whatnot. So anyway, he's here now, and I'd like to welcome him. Dr. Corral, thank you. And, I forgot, of course, to present Dr. Corral with the certificate, Lorenz Lecturer Certificate for 2011. So.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I can start. Okay. Well, thank you very much. It is really an honor, a privilege, and a pleasure to be here in San Francisco giving this lecture. Well, this should be about some atmospheric phenomena, but let me start with talking about earthquakes. And this is the nonlinear focus group. I'm allowed to do that. Okay, well, most of you know much better than me the Gutenberg-Richter law, but perhaps there is some student here or some people that is not a seismologist or not a nonlinear geophysicist who haven't heard about it. So it is rewarding to devote some time to explain this important law. In fact, this is not only the most important law for the statistics of seismicity, together with the Mori law, but it's also a cornerstone of nonlinear geophysics. The idea is very simple. Consider some region, for example, the whole world, for some period of time. Then it turns out to be that the number of earthquakes with magnitude greater than 8, okay, is in factors 10. So for each earthquake with magnitude greater than 10, there are 10 earthquakes with magnitude greater than 7, 100 earthquakes with magnitude greater than 6, and so on. And that's a very simple law. So every student now should remember forever, I hope. Well, you can see this in the log linear plot. You have a log linear plot and a straight line. So this means that the probability distribution of the magnitude is an exponential distribution with a V value very close to 1. Okay? The law is not only valid for the whole world, it's also valid for a smaller region, either for microseismic activity in small areas, reaching magnitude around minus 4. So there is really an enormous range of validity. What does the Gutenberg-Richter law mean? Well, the magnitude, in fact, is not a proper physical variable because it has no unit, so it's better to work with the seismic moment. That seismic moment is an exponential function of magnitude. Then, if one performs a simple change of variable, it turns out that the exponential distribution of magnitude transforms into a power law distribution of seismic moments. Okay? And then, for the probability density, it turns out that the exponent is around 1.7. Okay? In the tail of the distribution, you can fit other functions, but you cannot reject the simple power law fit. So this is for the whole world as well. And the same should hold for energy, because energy is roughly proportional to seismic moment, so the power law distribution does not change. Okay? Well, power law distributions have some counterintuitive consequence. One of them is that the One of them, oh, sorry. One counterintuitive consequence is that if you calculate the mean, it turns out to be infinite. What does it mean? That it means that the rare events, even though they have a very small probability of occurrence, their contribution to the energy budget is not negligible. So one has to take into account this. Okay? These events are crucial for energy dissipation, and when you have a power law distribution, you have to be very, very careful, okay? If you don't have enough statistics in detail, you can have problems interpreting the mean average of something. And with power loss, you never have enough statistics in detail. This is a problem with power loss. Well, another property is scale invariance, okay? Scale invariance is just perform a linear change of scales in your variables. This is very simple change of scale by some contact factors. So if you impose the condition of scale invariance, this is a scale transformation, sorry, and this is the condition of scale invariance, means that the original function has to be the same, exactly equal to the transformed one. If you impose this condition, then it turns out that the only solution is the power law. The power law distribution is the only function that fulfills this for arbitrary scale factors, okay? So there is not possible to define a characteristic size or energy for a variable that is power law distribution. So if you arrive to some place and ask the innocent question, how big are earthquakes here? Then this question has no possible answer if the Gutenberg-Ritchie law holds. And this is what generally called scaling, and this is a one-dimensional example of scaling. Okay? Well, the Gutenberg-Ritchie law deserves an explanation. Okay, how can it be that the very small events and the very big earthquakes conspire together just to be in the same straight line, all of them? Well, a first explanation was proposed by Otsuka in the 70s. Okay, we can think about earthquake rupture as a cascade process, okay, in which you can make the analogy with some domino topplings. But you don't think about a row of pieces of domino, think rather on a network of pieces, okay? And do not think in deterministic toppling, as it happens in the usual context, but think on stochastic toppling. So in this way, a seismic fault can be considered as a set of patches that may fail and trigger other patches to fail with some probability. Okay? Well, this is nothing else than the classical branching process introduced by the so famous Francis Galton and the not so famous Reverend William Watson in the Victorian England in the 19th century. These people were not worried at all about earthquakes. They were worried about the extinction of aristocratic families. So the idea is that you start with one single element, one parent, and each parent generates descendants, which are other elements with some probability. Some probability generate 0, 1, etc. And the descendants, these new elements, behave in the same way, and so on. Okay? So then it turns to be that if the mean number of descendants per parent is smaller than 1, the family will extinct for sure. So the probability of extinction is 1. This means that the probability of survival is 0. You can see here, the probability of survival is 0. But if this mean value, the mean number of offsprings, is greater than 1, then you have a finite probability of survival. So it's not 0, the probability of survival. So maybe you don't get extinct. Okay, you can see here a larger version of this. You see indeed that the transition is very sharp. So this is analogous to a phase transition. Okay, this is an important point that we will use later. What we are most interested is in the size of an earthquake. So the size of an earthquake is given by the total number of individuals across all generations, or this would be also the total number of pieces that topple. Okay, so one gets this distribution, which has an exponential tail, okay, with a characteristic scale chi. Okay, but it turns out to be that this characteristic scale chi increases when the mean value of the number of offspring per parent approach 1 in such a way that it becomes infinite when this is 1. So when this is infinite, then the exponential does not contribute anymore and you get a power law distribution. Only in that case you get a power law distribution for your population. This means that the Gutenberg-Richter law holds only in this case, in this model, and then you need what is called a critical branching process to explain earthquakes, in which a fine tuning of the mean number of offsprings is necessary. Kagan has argued that this exponent should be, in fact, 3.5 for earthquake rather than 1.7, but, well, in any case, the question we want to answer now is what makes earthquakes critical? What is the reason, or why is the reason why this fine tuning of the parameter is given the Gutenberg-Richter law? Well, it is instructive to consider the what is called the self-organized branching process introduced by Stefano Saperian's co-workers. This is a particular realization of the branching process in which you have two offspring with probability P and zero offsprings otherwise. The important point is to limit the maximum number of generation, that is to introduce a boundary and take into account the number of individuals that reach the boundary of the system, okay? We will call this loss quantity. And then the parameter P is changed from realization to realization using this formula, okay? Taking into account the loss, the boundary loss, in such a way that if P is low, the P value is low, then these events, or this population will be small and will not reach the boundaries, so the loss and the boundary will be zero, and then P will increase. In the opposite case, when P is high, then these events are large, and the dissipation on the boundary will be also large, and then, in this case, P decreases in such a way that P tends to a critical value, okay, which in this case is 1/2 in this model. So this self-tunes the number of the mean number of offsprings to 1. Okay, these ideas, of course, are naturally and implemented in a natural way in the self-organized criticality theory of Perbach and co-workers from the 80s. And the essential idea, most of you know, is that the power law response emerges as a consequence of the attraction of the dynamics toward some critical point. And you can explain this with sampile paradigm or with the sampile metaphor. The idea is the same. Okay? You have a sampile with some boundary dissipation, so if there are few grains in the pile, then well, the pile is flat and the avalanches will be small and there is a tendency for the pile to grow. In the opposite case, if there are many grains, if the pile is very steep, then the avalanches will be very large and the pile decreases in such a way that this mechanism makes the slope of the pile fluctuate around some critical state. Okay. Well, why Perbach and other statistical, in fact, many statistical physicists became interested in this kind of problem? Well, the idea comes from the critical points of thermodynamic phase transition. If you consider a magnetic material, the atoms are spins, which may have two states, up and down, okay? So it turns out to be that this is like a small macroscopic compass, okay? So it turns out to be, if you are at a very high temperature, the disorder wins, let's say the disorder wins, and then you don't have cluster of aligned spines. In any case, the clusters are very small. You have a small cluster of up or down spins, but this gives no magnetization, so the material is not magnetic. Okay? In the opposite case, below the critical temperature, the order between the interaction triggers order, and then this makes that there is a big, very big cluster of spins pointing in the same direction, and this gives a magnetization. The transition between both behaviors is sharp, okay? And it constitutes a critical point in which you have clusters of all sizes, power law distributed. And this is the idea that gave rise to the self-organized criticality. Well, in this case, there is no self-organization in these systems. Well, going back to earthquakes can be a self-organized critical phenomenon. This was proposed by Itso and Matsutake, by Sornet, and by Back and Tak in the 20 years ago, okay? More or less. And the essential idea, now we can see that all these sample ideas can be translated into some spring block models, like the Barrich and Knopov model, and the dynamics is essentially the same. You have the same behavior for these systems. Okay? Well, summarizing, which are the ingredients for self-organized criticality? The ingredients for self-organized criticality are, well, you need to have time scale separation, a slow driving, which is fulfilling earthquakes. You need also to have threshold, which store the energy, and then after the threshold surpasses, to have some interaction, that this also is reasonable to happen in earthquakes. You also have an avalanche dynamic once the threshold surpasses, that this also happens, this is an earthquake. And you need to have power law distribution, which also happens in earthquakes. So, well, you also need some finite size scaling. I will talk later about finite size scaling. Okay, so we have a series of points that are fulfilled for earthquake, but you need also to take into account the existence of an underlying second order phase transition. This means this sharp but continuous transition that is more, in addition, reached by self-organization. For example, in the case of iron, which is a magnetic material, you can say that the critical temperatures are around 700 centigrades. Are in the case of the water, the critical point of water is at about 300 degrees centigrade and 200 atmospheres, and so on. So you should be able to say something similar to earthquake. You should see that there is a sharp transition between no activity and activity in the system, and to give some value, for example, of the stress at which this transition happens. Okay, perhaps this is an oxymoron, because if you are at the critical point, you cannot explore what happens a bit away of the critical point, and you cannot see how this transition is sharp. So I will come back to this later. Okay? It's interesting to mention that other authors, like John Randall, have considered not a critical point, but an spinodal line, which is related not to a second-order phase transition, but to a first-order phase transition. Okay? I'm taking here a restrictive classical definition of self-organized criticality, versus a non-classical self-organized critical definition by Lovejoy and Scherzer. So I will stick to this definition and see what happens, okay? Well, the concept of self-organized criticality has been very fruitful in geoscience. It has triggered experiments or measurements in many systems like rock falls and landslides, and also forest fire by Bruce Malamud and co-authors, also in volcanic eruptions, in auroras, and many other systems that you should know and have been presented in this conference across the years. Okay. Well, now I'm going to talk about a different symmetry of earthquakes that is not directly related with self-organized criticality. Here, probably you can see a painting. This is a painting it's a part of a painting of Salvador Dalí, who was a surrealist painter of the 20th century. You should see a person looking through a window, okay? And the idea is that you should go to the end of the room and see what happens with the picture, okay? I think it's not a good idea that all of them go to the end of the room. Another option is that you close a little your eyes, but I will do the job for you. So you still should see the person, and then we are going to make the figure smaller and smaller. When you make the figure smaller and smaller, you are removing degrees of freedom, okay? And this gives you a loss of information, okay? If we go ahead and ahead, we get a different figure, okay? The picture is different. This is the first step of a renormalization group transformation, just the removal of degrees of freedom. The second step is to restore the original size of the system, in this case of the figure. If we restore the original size, we get, I hope you can see that, we see how the woman looking through the window, who is called Gala, renormalized into the face of Abraham Lincoln. So this is an example of renormalized group transformation. In magnetic systems, you can apply similar ideas, okay? You have a system of spins, a row of spins, then you remove some spins, and you get this other system, and then after this, you rescale the system. Okay? This is a transformation. If you iterate this transformation, you are applying the renormalization group. The idea is that for magnetic system, if you are below the critical temperature, this thing renormalizes to total magnetization, complete magnetization. On the other hand, if you are above the critical temperature, this system renormalizes to totally zero magnetization. Okay? So the system is not invariant under renormalization group transformation, as the picture that we saw, except at the critical point. At the critical point, there is invariance under renormalization group transformation. We can try to apply similar ideas to earthquakes. Okay, this is seismic activity. This is magnitude versus time. Okay. We have here worldwide seismicity, earthquake with magnitude greater than 5 for 1 year. Okay. And we are going to remove events. We are going to remove all the events that are below magnitude 6. Okay. If we remove these events, this is what we get. Of course, we get less events. And now we are going to restore the original number of events. We are going to contract the axis. Instead of 1 year, we are going to contract the axis a factor 10. This is given by the Gutenberg-Richter law. Okay, because we are removing 90% of the event and we are keeping 10%, so there is a factor 10. And this is what we get. We get something, this is 10 years of earthquake with magnitude greater than 6. We get something that is very similar to the original one. This was the original one, and this is the transformer one. Okay, we see that at least visually we have some similarity. Okay. Well, what does the theory say about that? If we consider the renormalization of the waiting time density, this is the time between events above a certain threshold, okay? If we consider a process with no correlations, magnitudes and times are independent, it turns out to be that the waiting time distribution transforms in this way, okay? This transformation is the one that gives us the new waiting time density in Laplace space. So in Laplace space, the formulas are simple, okay? Well, where P is the probability of survival of the removal, okay? P is, let's say, 10%, as before, 10% of the event survive. If we impose the condition of a fixed point of this transformation, okay, the transformer one has to be equal to the original one, we get that the solution of this corresponds to an exponential distribution. An exponential distribution corresponds in turn to a Poisson process, so it turns out to be that the Poisson process is the only fixed point of this transformation, okay, and in addition is an attractive fixed point, okay. Other distributions renormalize to an exponential distribution. So for this reason, it's an attraction, it's the attractor. Okay, this is well known, but one can go beyond this and consider nonlinear rescaling. Instead of rescaling linearly with the probability of removing events, we are going to rescale by some power of this. Then the new transformation is this one, and it turns out that the attractive fixed points of the transformation are rather different. You get this more or less complicated formula for the case R equal to 2, okay. In general, you get distributions that are double power law. You have a double power law with a small exponent for small values and a large exponent for large values. Okay, you can see here how the transformation works. You start with this function here and you apply the transformation and you get different function. If you rescale, you see that this thing converts to this double power law distribution. This is in some sense analogous to the central limit theorem, okay, in which the Poisson process is playing the role of the normal or of the Gaussian distribution, and this double power law distribution is playing the role of the Levy stable distributions. Okay, so there is a kind of analogy here in this result. Well, we can see what happened in earthquake, considering worldwide seismicity. These are the curves that we get. This is waiting time distributions. Okay, and this is how this curve renormalizes after the threshold is increased, magnitude 5, 5.5, etc. And then after rescaling the axis, we get this data collapse. Okay, this is rescaling the axis. This is the second step of the transformation. We get this data collapse, and this data collapse implies that we can write a scaling law. Okay, the waiting time density can be expressed in this way with a unique function f. So the shape is the same. Okay, and this R is the mean rate, the rate of occurrence, which is given by the Gutenberg-Richter law. Okay, this law has an enormous range of validity as well. I think John Davison has investigated this and will explain this tomorrow. Okay, but we can realize also that the function F is not given by an uncorrelated model. An uncorrelated model does not explain this. It is possible also that this is not explained also by a model with short-range correlation, because in critical phenomena, short-range correlation renormalized to non-correlation. Then this signals the importance of consider long-range correlation. And for example, Lenars and others have studied that, this. Okay. But also it's important to mention that the ETAS model, that is a very important model for trigger seismicity, does not fulfill an scaling law exactly. This is what this was found by Sachif and Sornet. Okay, so it is an open question, is this law is fulfilled exactly or not exactly, whatever exactly means for observational data like this. Okay, well, finally, to conclude this short review of scaling earthquake, the unified scaling law of Per-Back and co-authors can be computed in a similar way, computing waiting times, but in small areas of size L, many small areas, and count them together into a unique distribution. Then it turns that this distribution is a mixture of the previous distribution that we were found, and we can see also that there is a kind of scaling law here relating the waiting time distribution with the Gutenberg-Richter law and the fractal distribution of epicenters. Okay, and this is also related with the fact that the seismic rec is power law distributed in space and time. Okay, well, you can find that this p-value now is not the p before, this should be the Omori p-value, okay? Well, it's also important to mention that a multifractal approach was developed by Molchan and Conrad that is very pertinent here. Okay, and now I will move to consider tropical cyclones. Tropical cyclones are, tropical cyclone is the generic name for a phenomenon, okay, that are comprised by hurricanes or typhoons if the winds are strong enough, or tropical storms if the winds are not so strong, and tropical depressions if the winds are weaker. There are precise thresholds for this, but I will not introduce them. So it is well known that there is a large temporal variability in tropical cyclone occurrence. For example, you can compare 12 hurricanes in 1969 with only two hurricanes in 1983 in the North Atlantic. So this is a large factor of variability. Also, this high and low tropical cyclone activity comes into clusters. So in the 50s and in the 60s, the activity was high, 3.3 average major hurricanes in the North Atlantic, whereas in the 70s and in the 80s, the activity was rather low. Okay? Elsner and co-author, and also Goldenberg and co-author, realized that a new period of high activity started in 1995 in the Atlantic. You can see this is number of major hurricanes versus time. You can see the different periods and how in 1995 the high activity starts again. Okay? This is just counting earthquakes. There are other measurements to account for tropical cyclone activity, duration, another thing more complicated. All indications mark a substantial increase in activity in the North Atlantic after 1995. Well, an interesting measurement of activity is energy, okay? We could compute the energy of a hurricane. Here you have different image of Hurricane Katrina for different days. So the energy comes from the integral of the cube of the velocity field across surface and across time. Okay, so if we are able to compute this velocity field, perform this integral, we should obtain an estimation of dissipated energy, in this case for Hurricane Katrina. But unfortunately, the best track records of hurricanes do not contain this information. They contain much less information. Instead of one velocity field, they just contain one single value of the velocity, just one number every 6 hours. So every 6 hours, there is just this single number, the maximum sustained speed. Well, so this is the information. This is the only information that there is in best track record for Hurricane Katrina. This is velocity versus time. And you see the different categories and all that. Well, in order to solve this problem, Kerry Emanuel proposed that the energy, instead of being calculated with this formula, could be estimated with a much simpler formula, just integrating the cube of this maximum velocity. This was taking advantage of the similar similarity of hurricanes in space. Okay. Well, this thing is called power dissipation index, but it's a rough estimation of energy, not power. Okay, we're estimating energy. Okay. Well, this is what Kerry Emanuel obtained after summing all hurricanes year after year. So these are years, and this power dissipation index, okay, for all the hurricanes and tropical cyclones that were taking place in a given year. There is a large upswing in the last decade, and this was related with the effects of global warming. So what we are going to see here is how the ideas of earthquake that we have explained before can be applied to the system of tropical cyclones. Okay? So instead of studying the energy dissipated year after year, we are going to see the energy dissipated by individual tropical cyclones. Okay? Which is the distribution that an individual tropical cyclone dissipates. So if we consider about 40 years of data in the North Atlantic, hurricanes, including also tropical storms. Okay, you compute the power dissipation index, this raw energy, and make the statistic. This is the probability density in log-log scale. We see that we can fit a power law for some part of the distribution, but we have deviation. We find deviation at a small value for this PDI. These deviations are natural because the records are not complete. There are missing stars. For example, the record does not include tropical depressions. Tropical depressions are not included here. So it's normal to have a deviation. But also, there is a deviation here as well. Okay. I forgot to mention the exponent is around 1.2. Okay, the exponent of the density. Well, what happened with this hurricane here? How they are? We can plot them, and we see that all of them are more or less similar. Okay, they occupy the whole North Atlantic, and essentially they cannot become larger because they have no room to grow anymore, because either they reach land and get dissipated in land, or they reach high latitudes and are dissipated as well. So this is an indication that this effect is in fact an effect of the finite size of the ocean. Okay, we cannot make the ocean larger to see what happened, but we can make it bigger, smaller, just taking piece. If you take some piece of size 20 degrees or something, okay, this is what you get. This is the original curve. This is for 20 degrees, 10 degrees, and 5 degrees, and so on. This is the distribution. You see that the distribution is essentially the same, but it's moving to the left. So this effect is moving to a smaller values, and then you can, if you rescale the axis, you get a data collapse. So this indeed, this data collapse is what is called finite size scaling, and means that the cutoff at large PD values is a finite size effect. Okay, so essentially what we should have is a power law if we wouldn't have the boundary. The boundary is introducing this sharp cutoff. Then you can find an exponential here. Okay. Well, you can also study the influence on the size of tropical cyclones, the influence of sea surface temperature on the size of tropical cyclones. Okay, here you have sea surface temperature, and here you have time. You see this quantity fluctuates. Okay, and we are going to separate hot years and cold years. Okay. Well, if you do that, then the distribution splits into two. You get two distributions. I'm going to make it this bigger. Okay, and this is what you get. You get a blue curve corresponding to cold years and a red curve corresponding to hot years. So essentially, you keep the same shape of the distribution, but move to the left when the sea surface temperature is cold. Okay. Well, you can rescale these things again to see that the shape is the same. It's only a change of scale. But one has to be careful here that the distribution does not scale linear with the mean. This is a consequence of power law distributions. Well, I think I can skip this. The main idea is if you have a distribution like this with a cutoff, it turns out to be that the mean value of your variable does not scale linearly with the cutoff, but with some power. And you have to be careful. You can estimate these factors using this moments ratio, and if you plot this thing, you should able to verify that if this data collapse fulfills or not. And here you can see that indeed the cutoff does not scale linearly with the means, but with some power if beta is greater than one. is scaled superlinearly. So one has to be careful also when dealing with extreme events. Well, in order to see if this effect is due to sea surface, to duration or to intensity, remember that PDI can be considered the product of duration by mean intensity. By mean intensity, we mean the average of the cube of the velocity. So the PDE can be increased because an increase on duration or an increase in intensity. In fact, if we separate this into cold years and hot years, we see no difference. When the duration is fixed, the PDI is also fixed. So the sea surface temperature has no influence on the PDI for a fixed duration. And then the increase in PDE is only given by the increase in the duration. As for high temperature, the duration are longer, then we get PDE longer. But this is what makes the increase in the PDE. Okay, so the increase in the intensity that one observes would be a byproduct. So essentially, this suggests that what sea surface temperature is doing when it's higher than the mean is that the main effect is the increase of the ocean, the increase of the part of the ocean which is able to trigger tropical cyclones. Okay? You have a bigger, warm ocean. And other effects are not so important. Okay? Well, you can compare the same for different years. Of course, this is the last years with the 70s and the 80s. We see a difference that is related to, of course, to sea surface temperature. But if we compare with the 50s, we see no difference between the current period, the last 10 years or so, with the 50s and the 60s. One has to be careful here because the data are not homogeneous, but this is what is obtained directly from the catalogs. Okay, this is rather universal. You can verify this in the North Atlantic, North East Pacific, Southern Hemisphere, with all the case exponents between 1 and 1.2. Okay, and this is remarkable despite regional difference. For instance, in the Western Pacific, the typhoons developed from the monsoon, whereas in the North Atlantic, they developed from easterly waves, depending on the category. In any case, the distribution are very close. So we are trying to relate self-organized criticality with tropical cyclones. The factors that control tropical cyclone genesis are sea surface temperature that has to be larger than 26 degrees, and also the vertical shear of the horizontal wind, and there are other factors, but these are the most important. And also one has to take into account the energy transfer, in which the energy source for tropical cyclone is the evaporation of water from the sea. Then the stronger the wind, the more evaporation. The more evaporation, the more heat released by condensation. The more heat released, the stronger the wind, and so on. So we have a positive feedback mechanism that makes that the tropical cyclone can develop as a kind of chain reaction or avalanche. Well, we can see that tropical cyclones verify many of the requirements for self-organized criticality. Okay, we have a slow driving given by solar radiation. We have a storage of energy given by the heat in the sea. We have a threshold. That one threshold is the sea surface temperature. There are other thresholds. Also, one needs an external trigger. Okay. And the spread of energy is given by the wind and the condensation that I have just explained. You can compare this, for example, with earthquakes or with sand piles to see the analogies between this phenomena. Well, now it's interesting to compare also with rainfall, because I haven't mentioned, but tropical cyclones are storms, and then they provoke also rainfall. Here, this is a statistic for rain events. This was originally studied by Ole Peters and co-workers. This is the distribution of rain event sea size, okay, which is a power law distribution. Okay, so the rain fulfills a power law distribution. Well, then Ole Peters and David Nelly have shown first the existence in the atmospheres of a non-equilibrium stability-instability transition. Okay, you see here, this is the control parameter, that is the water vapor content, and this is the amount of rain, the rain rate. So we see here a sharp increase for different temperatures, that is very close to what is observed in a magnetic system. Okay? This is magnetization versus temperature. Okay, but not at the critical point, but close to the critical point. Close to the critical point, you have that the transition is not very sharp, but it's smooth in some way. So you can explain this because a finite system size introduces, breaks some correlation, and you are not precisely at the critical point. You have some correlation, and you are destroying, in some sense, the correlation in such a way that you are not precisely at the critical point. This depends on system size, okay, the size of the system, in such a way that if the size of the system goes to infinity, if you made the limit L going to infinity, then this function, this smooth function, transforms into a sharp power law transition. Okay, you get this thing. Okay, so you have a continuous phase transition, but with finite size effect. In the case of rain, the critical point was found to be around 63 millimeters of water vapor at 271 Kelvin, and so on. So indeed, you can say that there is a sharp transition at a precise critical point. But Peters and Nelling have also shown that the system has a tendency to be close to the transition. This curve here is the probability density of the water vapor content. As a function of water vapor content, we see a peak. The scale is logarithmic, so the peak is pronounced, very close to the transition. Okay, and this is related to Arakawa and Schubert's idea of quasi-equilibrium, that atmospheric convection takes place in a near unstable environment. Well, it turns out to be that hurricanes fit into this framework. This author studied also Hurricane Katrina and were able to measure rain and water vapor content in Hurricane Katrina, and you obtain the same curve, the same transition, and also the same distribution of water vapor content, so the system has a tendency to be close to this critical point. Well, I think I don't have time to read all the conclusions, but as this is the Lorenz lecture, it would be also interesting to see the consequence of a critical atmosphere for weather prediction. I think this was studied, something related to this was studied by Lovejoy and Scherzer, how the prediction in this extended spatiotemporal system is different from the deterministic chaos in low-dimensional systems. Just to finish, let me acknowledge Anna De Luca, Alvaro, Ole Peters, and Gunnar Prusnes, among many others, and that's all. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have time for one or two questions. Do we have any? Yes, Sergio.
Get the microphone here.
The connection between SOC and earthquakes, you made a number of points which make you think that it is earthquakes as SOC. But they're all based on the fact that there is a power law, nothing much beyond that. And you put, and this reminds us of a comment made by Nopov that a table has four legs, a cow has four legs, but the table is not a cow, which I think is harsh, but still we have to address it. And one of the ways you mentioned is looking at it as a second order phase transition, which is well-defined concept and theory. You have to find a critical point and a critical exponent. Do we have such a measure so that we can conclude that earthquakes are SOCs?
As far as I know, nobody has done such measurement because probably it's very difficult to have the information related to the stress in the crust. The advantage of the atmosphere is that the atmosphere is transparent, and you can measure many things in the atmosphere. But in the Earth crust, it's not so easy. But a similar approach to the one of Nielin and Peters could be applied to earthquakes to see an order parameter and a control parameter and see the relation between both that has to be sharp, and then that the system has to be close to the relation. But this is an open question.
Could you speak into the microphone? This is being taped.
Yes. A question related to the second part of your presentation, so when you analyze tropical cyclones. So in the index you use, I guess there are various, the definition is really, the PDI think in the, so somehow you have some cutoffs. You are taking, it's of course the information, as you correctly say, is very degraded on the right-hand side, but also on the left you are integrating over a time and you set a cutoff, initial time and final time cutoff, which is sort of subjective somehow. So my question is how robust these indicators are and how many events do you have to fit the power loss? Because I think this is a critical part, and that's an information I think it's important to know.
Mm-hmm. Here, for example, there are 500 events in 40 years. I'm sorry, the other part of the question was?
The robustness of this indicator. Why not the cube of that?
Well, the cube, it comes from this formula. This is fluid mechanics.
This.
The cube. But for example, if you introduce an square instead of a cube, this is called the ACE index, accumulated cycloid energy, you get something that is very, very similar if you don't use the cube and use a square. So, and the robustness, you can see here the robustness in the different basins. So, four different basins, you get essentially the same.
So it's 500 all together or for each?
No, each one is about 500, okay. More or less.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm very sorry, but we're a bit over time now, so I'm going to have to thank the speaker, and questions will have to come later. So thank you very much. I would like to now introduce our next speaker. I won't introduce the speaker. I will introduce... This will be done by Sergio Sharma, who's head of the Turcot Award Committee. He's the Turcot Award winner, Ian Groom, that introduced by.
The Turcot Award recognizes the achievements of a young colleague who has just completed his or her PhD dissertation in the last 1 year. And we have been giving this award for a few years now, and we have a committee of which I'm the chair, Christy Tempo, Toru Hada, Armin Bunde, and James Wanlis are in the committee. And this year we had a very competitive slate of nominees for this award, and we had to go through many rounds of discussions and voting to come to the final awardee, and the awardee this year is Ian. And I would very briefly introduce Ian to you. Ian attended College of William and Mary, and from where he got his bachelor's degree in mathematics. He moved to University of Colorado for his graduate school, and he got his PhD in applied mathematics. His thesis work was on rotating and stratified fluids and studies of asymmetric and other properties. And the Turcot Award is given on the basis of his thesis mainly, and of course recommendations and other factors. We are very pleased to have Ian here today to receive the award, and I would call up Ian to come and take the award from Sean, the certificate rather. Now I would like to invite Ian to give his talk. Now I'd like to invite Ian to give his talk on the interaction of mesoscale eddies and planetary geostrophy in the ocean.
Sure wasn't a Mac, I guess.
Yes, definitely PC.
There you go.
Okay. All right, thank you all for being here. I'm going to talk briefly about one of three projects that I worked on for my dissertation at the University of Colorado. I was planning to thank, you know, my committee members, but for the sake of time, I'm just going to thank them all as a group without mentioning names. I am going to mention Keith Julian was my graduate advisor at the University of Colorado, and he basically taught me the methods that I'm going to talk about today. Because this is a nonlinear geophysics session and not an ocean science session, I'm going to mainly focus on the methods that we used and not so much on the results. I have one slide at the end for the results, and I may not get to that because of time constraints. But the idea is we're interested in the interaction of large and small scales in the oceans. This is just a slide to give you an idea of what I'm talking about. There's nothing in particular in this slide that that I want you to get, besides the fact that there's some small-scale eddy-type structures, and then there's also some large-scale circulations, which are less evident in the figure, but you have a clockwise circulation in the subtropical gyre and a counterclockwise circulation in the subpolar gyre, which are, they constitute the large scales. This thing in the Sahara is actually the Gulf of Mexico, which has been wrapped around, in case you're wondering. The method that I'm going to talk about is really a method which applies to the interactions between scales. And so instead of talking about specifically the analysis for the ocean, which is rather complicated, I'm just going to look at the analysis of the equation for advection of a tracer. So Q here is a scalar tracer, U is a velocity. And this is an equation for the advection of a scalar. The top line there can be thought of as applying at all scales. And what we're interested in is the next line down, the evolution of the large scales. And I've written this equation for the evolution of the large scales, which is true, assuming that you have the right F. And of course, there are many different ways of trying to decide what is the right F. And I'd like to make a distinction between, on the one hand, trying to analyze the interactions between scales and talking about what is the correct form of F that'll give you the right evolution of the large scales. And on the other hand, numerical methods, which are based on the analysis. I'm going to talk a little bit about numerical methods, but I didn't actually implement any based on the analysis. So don't expect me to show any implementations. Another question you could ask is, well, what exactly do I mean by this overbar? So there's a variety of different methods people have used. Large eddy simulation, where the overbar is a spatial filter, and then you parameterize F. F is the divergence of some unresolved flux of tracer, and then you try to come up with a method of parameterizing that. Reynolds averaging is not necessarily applicable to this, ensemble averaging, because you're not sure that the ensemble average of the tracer varies only on the large scales. The ensemble average could vary on small scales. Nonetheless, people talk about it, so I thought I'd put it on here. There's a variety of heuristic or ad hoc or physics-based parameterizations. As an example, you could say that the small scales in the mean equation just act to diffuse the large scale tracer down its gradient. There are stochastic parameterizations. I've shown just a simple example. There are, of course, a variety of different ways. And then there's a superparameterization, which is a numerical method. And when it was introduced, it was an ad hoc method, but it's since then been connected to an analytical method for understanding the interactions between the scales, that analytical method being multiple scale asymptotics. And the method is what I'm going to talk about, but it's connected, the analytical method is connected to this numerical method of superparameterization. So superparameterization is something that was introduced in the late 90s, early 2000s in the atmospheric setting by Wojciech Grabowski and collaborators. It's since then moved on to a variety of things. I pulled this image from a recent paper in ocean modeling just to give you a feel for it. So on the left you have the large scale or resolved tracer, which you're evolving on some coarse grid. And then at each coarse grid point, you have a small fine grid box, which is disconnected from all the other fine grid boxes, and you solve some prognostic model for the dynamics in the small scale box, and then use those dynamics which you've solved for to compute the effect on the coarse grained solution. Now, this, as I said, was developed in an ad hoc way, and it seemed to work quite well. And then in 2007, Andy Maida wrote a paper where he showed that in the cloud resolving convection parameterization context, where this method was first developed, there is an analytical justification for that algorithm based on multiple scale asymptotics. And we used multiple scale asymptotics to look at the ocean problem. Now, when I say multiple scale asymptotics, I think for a lot of people that evokes images of sort of solitons and coherent structures. And really, that's not very related to the method as we use it. The way that we use it is more related to homogenization theory. Just very briefly, you have two or many scales, an inner scale sub I, an outer scale sub O, and the ratio between those scales is small. So you introduce, here on the second line down, you introduce extra independent variables corresponding to the extra scales. And then you introduce this average, which is crucial to the application of the method, where you average over the small scales, leaving only a large scale quantity. By definition, and for the formal application of this method, the average has certain properties. It's a projection, so if you apply it twice, you get the same thing. And then also, it has the same properties as a Reynolds average. Now, what's interesting, or an interesting thing about this, is that in order for the method to be really formally applicable, or you can always apply the method, but you may not expect the results to be right. And you should expect the results to be right if you can define a real averaging operator, maybe a spectral truncation or a local average, which has properties approximately the same as this. What's interesting is that even in settings where there is no way to define a real average that has these properties, for example, in a turbulent system that has energy at a wide range of scales with no gap in between them, you can still apply the method of superparameterization, and it still seems to work, which is something that needs explanation. But anyway, this is the method. If you apply it to the tracer equation, on the top line you have, I've added the extra scales. On the next line down, I've applied the average. And then you use the rest of the method to derive equations for U prime and Q prime, prognostic equations for the small scale unresolved variables. And those allow you to compute this tracer flux, U prime, Q prime bar, which gives you the evolution of the large scale variable. And you can do that with the method, the numerical method of superparameterization. So we applied this to ocean dynamics. It was a complicated problem, which is why I didn't want to go into the details right here. And we came to the result that there are three regimes, effectively. If the eddy velocities and the mean velocities are approximately the same, then you get a connection from the mean to the eddies. But in fact, you get no connection from the small scale dynamics back into the large scales. This is a limit that had been investigated by Joe Pedlosky. We further showed that if the eddy velocities are much larger than the mean velocities, then you can get a connection from the eddies to the mean. The small scales will force the large scales, but the large scales seem to ignore the small scales in that limit. And finally, if you have some anisotropy in the large scale flow, for example, in the Antarctic circumpolar current or in western boundary currents, then you can get the two-way connection. And more details are in this paper in Dynamics of Atmospheres and Oceans 2011. Here's a short list of some selected references in case you want more details. Thank you.
Thank you. We're almost on time, so we have questions. Have time for some questions. Nobody has any questions. Ah, in the back, yes. I would like you to come and speak into the microphone, if possible, please. It's session is being taped, and I have to speak into the microphone.
On the previous slide, you had when the eddy velocity and the mean velocity. Oh yeah, the second one, when the eddy velocity is much larger than the mean velocity, you have some results. But I was wondering if it has anything to the flow being close to two-dimensional in that case, or do you have anything to say about that? Because in 2D turbulence, there is a similar result, I guess.
Right. In the analysis here, we actually we slaved the two-dimensional dynamics on the large scale to the baroclinic or the three-dimensional dynamics, because the analysis was difficult enough that bringing that extra layer in on the large scale complicated things a little too much. So on the small scales, we have the issue of the 2D, but on the large scales, we don't. So I'm not sure if I can answer that question.
I'm afraid we're going to have to move on to the next session. Otherwise, we'll be very unpopular with the organizers of the next session. So I'd like to thank Ian once again for his talk. And thank you all for coming.